son and grandson of strict and particular Baptist preachers, what did the King James Bible mean to you growing up, in your own childhood, at least?
It was the word of God. God spoke to these men, clearly. It was the bedrock of my upbringing, which I went on to rebel against and then got captured by the good Lord anyway. So yes, it was the authoritative word of God from which the authority of the preaching was based and so on. And it's strange, you know, you leave. I'm happy to read new translations, so I should leave that. But it was in making this film, I actually came back to look again at the King James Bible, and I love it. I've got it as an app on my iPhone, I love it. And I read it daily there. Because there is something special about that translation. All credit to many other translations. A few paraphrases leave me cold. The little fuddly and scouse Bible didn't quite do it for me. But the more I learned about the history, and the more I learned about how it's made, it just fascinated me all again. And I do believe it still communicates very strongly and very beautifully. That's the thing that actually got me most of all. King James said, "Wait, before you go and start translating, I've got one more command." He said, "Make it beautiful." Mm-hmm. Academics can take note of that piece of work.
Moving swiftly on, though. As we saw in the film, this was a translation done by a committee. As a filmmaker, wanting to reach larger audiences, what was the challenge for you in making a film about a book translated by a committee? In other words, how to make this into an engaging story, which I think everyone in the audience would agree you've done. But how did you begin to conceive of that challenge and approach it?
Rule number one, avoid committees. I think. I was left very much myself. It wasn't actually commissioned by the BBC, it was commissioned by an independent financier who wanted this to be done. And that was wonderful. It left me completely free to be able to do what I wanted without the phone calls from head office saying, ooh. Yeah. So I enjoyed that immensely. I think the decision came early on. I have sort of strong views on television and communication, really, yes, because I've done it all my life. The decision came early on not to do an illustrated lecture. And you can do illustrated lectures. I don't think it's good television. Very rarely is it good television. You can still work hard and get things from them. Interesting, the BBC went on to commission two films that were illustrated lectures, and they had very moderate response. I wanted this to be story. Story, story, story. And I think with story, you can get an awful lot of information in. You remember an awful lot of this. I think Murray Watts, who wrote the drama and played Chatterton, for nothing, because that's not much money. But he wanted to write himself in, so he did. He did a great job with the actual real drama. It isn't what I call waxwork drama. I don't like that very much. The illustrative, you know, the nice light coming through the window, the bowl of lemons or something on the table, a wistful look. It's Madame Tussauds, that isn't real drama. I think people are really people. And we are interested in people, we're interested in characters. And especially the more dark and twinkly they are. I find myself regularly thanking God for the fallen nature of man. Am I wrong? Am I erring? Because without that, you wouldn't have many good stories or much humour. But when you do get that, and you get actors that enjoy the roles that they did, we laid under tremendous limits, lack of finance. We did it for about 35% of what we would normally get for a film. But everyone was so enthused and went with it. And they knew that it was working well. And John Rhys-Davies, better known for the dwarf in Lord of the Rings, of course, Gimli and other things, actually quite tall. But he was in love with the King James Bible. I haven't realized this is one of the reasons I chose it as a presenter. And it was important to have an actor so that you could link the dramatized sections with the more documentary sections. And he just relishes that book, which is wonderful. And in the extras for the DVD, he talks about himself, about his own journey.
Thank you. Let's open it up now for your questions and comments. Please, would you stand and speak clearly so that everyone can hear? We're not using mics. If you'd like to stand, thank you.
Thank you. That was wonderful. And I do have a question about the writing of King James for the film. You mentioned Murray Watts. I thought the script was brilliant. Could you tell us a little bit more about him and what he's done and how he's worked?
Sure. I've worked with Murray for ages. He's we met, goodness me, about 30 years ago. He is a Christian man, he is a writer, he just had three plays on at the Edinburgh Festival. He has suffered hard for his own art because no one pays anything. But he also is holed up in a collapsing castle 3-4 miles south of Drummond Road in the far north of Scotland. If you want to visit him, he does have accommodation. He must go to see him. But he is a good soul, and he got this. How do you do this? How do you tackle? I didn't really answer your question, did I? Let me do it very simply, and this will help. I look at it as a three-ring circle, ever decreasing. The first thing was the research, and I was very fortunate. I mean, you can read books and so on, as one does. But if you read, talk to the people who've written the books, it's wonderful, because then you get everything, including their enthusiasm and the light in the eye. So I did the research, and then interviewed people, or at least one person is here today, is one of those. I found myself just absorbing this stuff from long conversations with them all, which you can collect, because you're never sure if you're going to have enough money to finish. I certainly wasn't. So you collect a good, strong interview set from many people. Actually, some of them were not shown here. There's another extra on the DVD which has a lot more of the commentary. Because at that point, I didn't know fully what I could afford at the end. But you've got the information, and it's pulsing. And then within that, I thought, I've got to get the presenter. So I get John Rhys Davies across from New Zealand, and he walked around and did this, and I made him do far more quick pieces of camera than I showed him there, because I didn't know I'd have enough time to dramatize, or enough money to dramatize. And then finally we got just about enough, the sad story there, it wasn't quite. But everyone went for it anyway. I said, we're going to do a talking head show, or we're going to do drama, and there was no question. So I showed that cut at that stage to Murray, and talked him through what I wanted. He went away and produced wonderful bits of drama that I think are real and human and engaged, which is what I wanted. And then we threw ourselves at having to be done in 12 days, which is very quick, considering the travel between locations. And then half the money didn't turn up, so we had to do it 6 days. Nonetheless, everyone died happily. And it was a tough call. But because of that, the wider thing, and going in, and so you knew specifically what you were aiming for in the drama. You didn't waste money with things you cut out. So that was the way I approached it, and Murray did a great job, so I'll pass it on.
But following on from that, were there ever times when you and Murray disagreed, or you changed his text because you as the filmmaker, the director, saw something you thought he didn't, or?
We gave fairly specific, briefings. I couldn't afford to pay him, I paid him a little, you must understand I didn't pay money. And I took on some of the smaller scenes myself because I knew what I wanted to say through them, so some of it's mine, but I give my own credit for it. So there wasn't any time to argue too much, we had limited amounts of space to do it in. I think Murray did, he's a great scholar, comes from Emmanuel College in Cambridge where Chatterton was a big hero, is a big moment. He already was very well versed in the story, and I think Paul came together.
Thank you. Other comments or questions, please? Yes.
I was a little surprised that you didn't mention any of the translators, you know, that came before the, you know, committee that put it together, which they relied heavily on.
Tyndale is my big error.
Yeah.
I say error. I did weakness. I gave in to not mentioning Tyndale, and now there's talk of doing a prequel where Tyndale would get his proper mention, because undoubtedly an awful lot of that was based on that. And I look back at it and I regret keeping him out completely. The way we took it was historical. I didn't want to make this just so much of a Christianized religious pamphleteering sort of thing that it would be not viewed by the ordinary man in the street. And this is made for ordinary viewers, it's not made for the Christian gallery. And I wanted to come at it through the historical character of James. And when you do that, and you start tying it down on his story, it is a slightly different arc that I've chosen than to do it sort of chronologically from the first moments. And I was showing this at the Bible Society in New York, and somebody mentioned that, and then we said, well, why not a prequel? And someone said, yes, this is it. So apparently, and that gentleman is out there looking for money to do a prequel on Tyndale, which you could do. He was an amazing character. Died before he was 4 years old. I get excited.